All right, joining us now is His Excellency Councillor Parks Tau, the Mayor of Johannesburg, and also the preferred candidate for Johannesburg by the ANC. Thanks so much, Councillor, for your time. Congratulations are in order. Were you surprised at the nomination?
Thank you very much, and good afternoon. Of course, one doesn't always have an expectation. You are nominated by branches and the region of the ANC, but ultimately the leadership of the ANC makes the decision. The PEC did confirm the decision earlier this week. But you still needed the national leadership to affirm the decision.
Were you at any point uncertain of whether you'd make the nomination list as a mayor of Johannesburg?
Well, you know, you do think about the issues that the ANC has to juggle around and think about the different options that the leadership should apply its mind to and the possibility that there would be changes possibly in Johannesburg. So there were times that I was anxious myself.
All right. And what, playing through those thoughts, what do you think or who would you have thought to be a better candidate than yourself?
Well, we had two other candidates. Remember, we had to submit three candidates as the ANC. One of the decisions we made in the city of Johannesburg is that we'll send candidates, whilst it's in order of preference and priority, we'd still send candidates that would be capable to lead the city of Johannesburg in the ANC Deputy Chairperson and Speaker of Council, Connie Bapela, and member of the Mayoral Committee, Tsidi Mfiko, who is also a member of our Regional Executive Committee and Regional Working Committee. So I thought that we had capable people that equally could be able to take on the task of leading the city of Joburg.
Yeah, but is there a sense of pressure that you want to win that even propels you more to want to win because of the nature of the competitiveness of making it on the candidates list?
Well, I mean, when the issue is raised, you do put yourself up. You have been doing a job. There are programs that we would want to continue implementing. There are programs that are very close to my heart in terms of the initiatives that we're undertaking as the city of Johannesburg, and a lot of them I'd like to see through. So yeah, there are times that you do become anxious, but I think it's more about the commitment to serving the people of Johannesburg, to serving the people of this country, that one almost feels that I actually still want to continue in this task.
Yeah, and there's a vote of confidence with you having made it as the mayoral candidate for the ANC in Johannesburg. Is that what you feel, in the sense that the leadership at various levels are proud of what you're doing and they endorse your work ethos and the projects that you've done so far?
I think it's an affirmation of the work that we're doing in the city of Johannesburg and the way in which we've been leading both the municipality and the African National Congress. And I think that's how the ANC possibly looked at the issue and said, well, we think that we have reason to reaffirm this candidate to continue the work that he's been doing and leading a city and an institution that is making significant progress in a number of areas. And certainly I think that it's a commitment by the ANC to continue those programs.
Mm. There's also the contest, of course, by the DA with Herman Mashaba as their mayoral candidate, who's already made inferences regarding Pick It Up, which is a contentious issue when it comes to the city of Johannesburg. And the way Pick It Up has been run, there had been allegations of corruption there. Herman Mashaba saying that he's the go-to guy. He will champion that particular issue and create much-needed employment. Why is it that Pick It Up is so problematic?
Well, we've received a number of allegations against management in Pick It Up. Our commitment has always been that if there's an allegation against any person in the city of Johannesburg, that we will investigate, finalize the investigation, and where action needs to be taken, we'll take due action. We are expecting a report from the investigators during this week that would indicate what the outcome of the investigation would be. I always think that you need to be very proactive in the way in which you deal with issues, and that allegations that come through need to be followed up. And you need to give assurance to the people of the city that we're committed to clean governance and to accountability.
But it's a perennial problem. I mean, it hasn't been the first municipal strike or the fact that litter had to pile up in the streets of Johannesburg. Pick It Up is almost holding the municipality to ransom in the way it runs its business. And yet it's an agency of the council or the city of Johannesburg. Why is it that you don't seem to be able to distinguish as to who must salute who in this game?
Well, I mean, we've said, and we said this during the strike, that we think it is unfortunate, taking into account that it is considered an essential service, at least after 7 days, that requires that workers be back at work and engage with us. We committed, when the workers raised their demands, to look into the demands and to process them. And I think it was unfortunate that they went on to an unprotected strike that literally made it difficult for the city to be able to manage it. And we continue to engage with the unions around finding long-term solutions. And some of the issues that they've raised are indeed legitimate, and we've looked at them and have acceded to them. We've spoken about a long-term program of creating parity within the different salary bands of the organization so that people are employees that are happy at work, and we are committed to continuing to do that. With regards to some of the ideas that have been bandied around, I don't think that the proposals that have been bandied around are actually going far enough. At least in line, our thinking is a lot more comprehensive in terms of how we'd want to deal with the agency, because waste has become a resource that could be used. You can recycle, reuse, you can generate energy. So we're looking more at involving communities in the process of waste management through our Jersey at Work program, so that the way in which you deliver the service creates jobs, creates enterprise development opportunities, and also introduces new technologies. You would know that.
One would argue, why haven't you done it? I mean, it took Herman Mashaba from the DA to suggest that they will break up into smaller components, pick it up and create employment, take it back to the community, and you seem to be saying the same.
No, we've started. We've started. In fact, Mashaba is not coming with any new idea. We've started. We've got a lot of waste management that's done by community organizations. We've started through our Jersey at Work program to engage community-based enterprises and small enterprises in the waste management cycle. We've started with generating energy from our landfill sites. So those are programs that are already underway. So I don't think that the proposals that he's come with have actually been thought through, because he's talking about creating 7 new enterprises as opposed to, in fact, the number of small-scale enterprises that we create in the city of Joburg.
Yeah. This world-class African city only applies to a few. When you look at living conditions just in informal settlements, the oldest township in the country, Alexander Township, still being overpopulated. Why is it that people still live in such dire conditions there?
I spent the whole of the past week in Alexandra engaging with different stakeholders and communities. And one of the perennial issues has been the reality that the city and all of government have been interdicted by the property owners in terms of the redevelopment of Alexandra. And we've been negotiating with the property owners. We are on the verge of reaching agreement. In fact, I'm seeing the property owners tomorrow morning, and we anticipate that a deal would be struck by the end of this week. And from there, that would unlock the whole of the Alexandra renewal program, because the reality is that we've developed East Bank and different parts, Tsutsumani and so on. But the reality is that you still have congestion in old Alexandra. And if you're to resolve the problem, you have to resolve it with the property owners. And we've been inhibited by a court order that has stopped us from continuing. But as I said, I'm quite excited that we're on the verge of reaching agreement and signing on the dotted line.
The issue of land is really problematic, because you see this world-class development all over the place. Mall of Africa is a case in point. There's the Waterfall Estate and Stain City, etc., which are pockets of land that are individually owned or privately owned. How then, as a city, or what kind of power do you have or muscle in order to distribute land or more equitably in the city?
Well, we have the authority to purchase land and to expropriate in instances where the property owners have not voluntarily sold the land. We've just engaged in expropriation in Rabi Ridge Midrand to enable us to develop a particular portion of land that would unlock development for the Greater Ivory Park area. That's quite critical. So we use different tools to be able to access land. We've been purchasing different land parcels as we're implementing our Corridors of Freedom initiative. So land acquisition and land use are very critical. Now, I said land acquisition and land use, because one of the critical authorities of a municipality is to determine land use, the right to use land for a particular purpose in terms of our planning department. And we use that very actively to promote a world-class city and to promote integration in our city. We've got, for example, an agreement with the developers in Waterfall Estates and the developers in Modderfontein that there would be inclusionary housing in their development schemes. And as part of the programs that we're developing, we're presenting to Council a consolidated spatial vision for the city of Johannesburg.
But Councillor, it benefits the investors and the private landowners and render the greatest population of Johannesburg as consumers. There's been on Twitter somebody saying that there's nothing African about the Mall of Africa because it's still white owned, it's still anchored by your Pick and Pays, the Ackermans, the Oppenheimers, etc., that wealth is not distributed primarily to small black businesses in this province or city.
Know, one of the primary responsibilities of any municipality is actually town planning and land use, and it's about building a city that's more integrated and creates better equity, because for as long as people live in faraway distances from where the opportunities are, they're excluded simply by location to the opportunities that are in the city. So when we're talking about the corridors of freedom, we're talking about bringing people closer to where the opportunities are. We're now talking about developments taking place in South Hills. We've procured land in Patterson Park next to Houghton. And those sort of developments that bring people closer to where the opportunities are. In Fleurhof, we're developing housing opportunities there. So when I'm talking about land use, I'm talking about exactly that way. You're talking about a city that is more functional, that is more integrated, and that uses its land use decision-making authority to be able to influence spatial patterns and how people interface with their city. But we're also looking at programs of enterprise development. We've supported in excess of 24,000 enterprises, small enterprises, as the city of Johannesburg, one, to set up, two, to support them in terms of advice, in terms of business planning. We've created a financing scheme together with our bankers as the city of Johannesburg that enables people to access financing from the city of Johannesburg. And we've developed a comprehensive youth development program titled Vulindlela Jozi.
Let's talk about the protection of small businesses, particularly where there is a greater concentration of black ownership. The taxi industry now having to face yet another imported competition in the form of Uber. There's been accusations as well that the rapid transport system has deprived those operators of greater opportunities when you introduce the system. What's your response to that?
No, in fact, the taxi operators are the owners and managers of the PRT in the city of Johannesburg. It is indeed an empowering program. It's always exciting when you think about it and say actually the PRT in Johannesburg is run by the taxi industry and they are running it professionally. There are now people that are educating different parts of this country and Africa on how to run a bus rapid transit system. And we were very deliberate in ensuring that we empower the taxi industry to be the owners of the PRT. The introduction of Uber is about a new innovation that's come on board and spread throughout the world. And it's something that we've always thought it's a matter that requires engagement with the industry as it exists. It does not necessarily develop to the exclusion of those who are participating. But we said to the Uber operators, at least in the city of Joburg, that we don't think that they should come in with the idea of excluding the current operators, but more look at it and finding more innovations that enable them to engage these people as participants.
But we're assuming that opponents. The playing fields are equal, and you're saying this is new innovation, and we know that well, the taxi industry is not as sophisticated as what the international competition would bring. So shouldn't you afford those vulnerable industries the opportunity at least of some form of regulatory protection when these kind of competition enters the market?
And that's where the provincial government has published a set of regulations for Uber and other operators in Gauteng. It's a provincial function to regulate that. And we've commented on the regulations. So I was talking more on the side of how do we enable and facilitate with those that introduce the new system to integrate the people that are already in the system so that you don't have the clashes that are there. It's not only happening in Johannesburg, it's happening throughout the world, in fact, where Uber is in competition with historic operators and there would be tension between historic operators and the new operators. And we've said to them, find a way of bringing them on board, but let's not chase it out. Let's not say to people, don't bring innovations that are working throughout the world into the city of Johannesburg in South Africa.
Yeah, the EFF has come out saying that they are answer to the have-nots or the poor, the indigent, that the ANC in Johannesburg or Gauteng primarily has ignored. Do you feel that this is a fair comparison or even allegation?
Well, what the EFF needs to understand is that the municipality has to generate revenue to be able to provide its services. We do buy and sell water, we do buy and sell electricity, we have to rate property to be able to generate property tax. They're talking about free everything. They're not talking about how they're going to get the resources to be able to deliver the free everything that they'll be delivering. So I don't think, they're only talking expenditure, they're not talking revenue. Running a municipality is not just getting a pot of money and spending it. People pay for those services.
Yeah.
And you need to take into account the impact on those rate payers and say, how do I increase my rates in a manner that is not to the detriment of the taxpayer. So you can't increase your taxes to the taxpayers to such an extent that you debilitate them in terms of their ability to access municipal services. So if you look at their expenditure program, you actually wonder where they'll be getting all the resources.
Well, okay, there's also been a question around wasteful expenditure in the municipality and the city. Going forward, how do you, or maybe let's just look at, quantify it, a ballpark figure of the money that has gone to waste, as it were.
Well, we've reduced it significantly, in fact, in the city of Johannesburg. If you look at an annualized figure, it's come to less than 20 million. But it's still a matter that is of concern, and we do hold people accountable and take corrective action against those officials that engage in wasteful expenditure in the city of Johannesburg.
All right, you didn't give us the ballpark figure. How much did you reduce it by, and what is it now for this fiscus?
Well, we reduced it, as I said, we reduced it to less than 20 million rands. But the annualized figure started, and wasteful expenditure is a question of sometimes people paying the service providers late and incurring interest payments. And those are the areas where we need to be able to reduce those expenditures. And we've reduced it from, as I said, when we started, it started at more than a billion rands, and we've reduced it to less than 50 million, of less than 20.
Are you concerned that the e-tolls will cost the ANC at the local government elections?
We as the ANC in Gauteng have continued to say that we think we need a review of the e-tolls. When we pronounce, for example, on the expansion of our road network and the recapitalization of our highway systems, we committed upfront that we're not going to toll them. At least that's the property of the municipality. We can make that decision as the municipality. But we continue to engage with government around the review of the e-tolls and looking at alternatives of how to finance that infrastructure.
But are you concerned that it might impact critical votes at the polls?
Well, we always remain concerned, because I think that every time people say we are concerned about something, you cannot just ignore it. And the voters have said to us, at least as the city of Joburg and to Gauteng, we're concerned about the implementation of the e-tolls. Therefore, the voters would continue to raise those issues, and we need to take them into account. But that's why we've called for a review, so that we don't ignore what the people are saying to government and to the African National Congress.
All right, Councillor, we really appreciate your time. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you very much.
Much appreciated. We're speaking to His Excellency Councillor Parks Tau, the Mayor of Johannesburg, and also the mayoral preferred candidate for the ANC.